The following Sunday, we will begin a study of the book of James. And with that being said, tonight I want to begin by reading the book of James, James chapter 1 to be precise, James chapter 1. I want to draw your attention to the book of James, the first chapter, and then the following Sunday, the 17th, we'll begin a slow and methodical study of the book of James. Lord, shift us in this season, and I feel his leading for the Mount Sinai Church family and friends to look at the book of Revelation on our Tuesday nights and then the book of James on our Sunday morning. Let's begin tonight by reading James chapter 1. Before we do so, just pray briefly with you for that you're in. God will sanctify that space. God will sanctify that space. That he will use that area to become your sanctuary. Let me say to you that it is critical to you that this is not a dualistic project. Meaning tonight is you enter worship. The Lord deserves your divided attention. And so I want you to tune in tonight just as if you were sitting in worship, more focused than even if you were sitting in worship. So let's actually pray for the sanctification of the space and then from there. Father, we are grateful. We are thankful for the blessed privilege that it is to come to you and to be able to express to you our need for you to help us not be distracted tonight, to help us, Lord, to be solely focused on everything that will take place within the constructs of this worship service. All these things we pray for Jesus' sake. Amen. James 1, reading as is our custom, from the English Standard Version of the Bible, says, James, a servant of God and of the Lord Jesus Christ, to the 12 tribes in dispersion, greetings. I count it all joy, my brothers, when you meet trials of various kinds. For you know that the testing of your faith produces steadfastness. And let steadfastness have its full effect, that you may be perfect and complete, lacking in nothing. If anyone lacks wisdom, let him ask God, who gives generously to all without reproach, and it will be given him. But let him ask in faith with no doubting, for the one who doubts is like a wave of sea that is driven and tossed by the wind. For that person must not suppose that they will receive anything from the Lord. He is a double-minded man, unstable in all his ways. Let the lowly brother boast in his exhortation and the rich in his humiliation, because like a flower of the grass, he will pass away. For the sun rises with his scorching heat and withers the grass, its flower falls and its beauty perishes. So also will the rich man in the midst of his pursuits. Blessed is the man who remains steadfast under the trial. For when he has stood the test, he will receive the crown of life which God has promised to those that love him. Verse 13, let no one say when he is tempted, I am being tempted by God. For God cannot be tempted with evil, and he himself tempts no one. But each person is tempted when he is lured and enticed by his own desire. He then desire, when it has conceived, gives birth to sin, and sin, when it is fully grown, bring forth death. Do not be deceived, my beloved brothers. Every good gift and every perfect gift is from above, coming down from the Father of light, with whom there is no variation or shadow due to change. Of his own will, he brought us forth by the word of truth, that we should be the kind of first fruits of his creations. Know this, My beloved brothers, let every person be quick to hear, slow to speak, slow to anger. For the anger of man does not produce the righteousness of God. Therefore, put away all rampant wicked filthiness and rampant wickedness and receive with meekness the implanted word which is able to save your soul. But be doers of the word and not hearers only, deceiving yourselves. For if anyone is a hearer of the word and does not and not a doer, he is like a man who looks intently at his face, his natural face in a mirror. For he looks at himself and goes away and once forgets what he was like. But the one who looks into the perfect law and law of liberty and perseveres, being no hearer who forgets, but a doer who acts, he will be blessed in all his doing. If anyone thinks he is religious and does not bridle his tongue, but deceives his heart, this person's religion is worthless. Religion that is pure and undefiled before God is faith. God the Father is this, to visit the orphans and the widows in their affliction and to keep oneself unstained from the word. This is the word of God. May the Lord add a blessing to the reader and hearer and doers of his holy word. Let's pray. God of grace, God of mercy, how we are grateful and thankful tonight for the blessed privilege it is to come before you and say to you, Lord, we desperately need you. We dare not trust tonight one's ability, talents, or gifts. Everything we do tonight is slanted towards who you are and a realization of who we are not. You are holy, Lord, we are not. You are perfect in all your ways, Lord, we are not. You are sinless, Father, we are not. So, Lord, we say, have thine own way tonight. Meet your precious people who are listening in various places tonight, some at home, others their place of work, maybe some place of leisure. Wherever you be tonight, I pray that you would make that sacred. I pray that you remove distraction. I pray that they will not be an analyzer tonight of tonight's service, but they will be a participant even in distance. Some are watching with family, friends, and loved ones. Some are watching in solitude tonight. Whatever the situation, Lord, I pray that your presence will have is of prevailing power in their midst. Thank you tonight that even in the midst of a pandemic, we can affirm your goodness and see your goodness and recognize your goodness. Even in the midst of pandemic and uncertainty among medical experts and political leaders and even some religious leaders, Lord, we still trust in the blood of Jesus, saving ourselves in the power of the Holy Spirit that leads us into truth, convicts us of a sin, gives us power to witness, and helps us live in a light in a way that is righteous like our Savior, Jesus the Christ. Father, we dare not suggest that we know what you're up to, but we are silencing ourselves and saying, speak, Lord. Your servants are listening. What a wonderful time to readjust our life. What a wonderful time this season is to reevaluate our life. What a wonderful time this season is to reprioritize our life. Help us to do so, Christ. Help us to do so, Lord, through the power of Christ, in order that when he returns to consummate his kingdom, we'll be ready for when Jesus come. All these things we pray tonight in the matchless, powerful, and wonderful name of our Christ and our Lord Jesus Christ. It's for his glory we pray. Let every believing heart say tonight, amen. Capilla is coming with a song of preparation, and then we're coming back with our lesson. Come on, give her a hand as she makes her way.
The Lord is my shepherd. I have everything I need. He lets me rest in the meadow's grass. He leads me beside the quiet stream. He restores my soul. That's why I'm safe. That's why I'm safe. I'm safe in his arms. Because the Lord is my shepherd. Lets me rest in his meadow's grass, and he leads me beside the quiet stream. He restores my sensitive soul, and he helps me do what honors him the most. That's why I'm safe. That's why I'm safe. I'm safe in his arms. So when the storms of life and the billows, they do roll, they roll. Glad that he shall be safe. I'm safe in his arms. Now won't you let the Lord be your shepherd? And he'll lead you beside the quiet stream. He'll restore your sin-sick soul. And he'll help you do what honors him the most. Won't you be safe? Won't you be safe? So when the storm, the storm of life is raging, and the billows, they roll, but I'm so glad. Jesus, he shall hide me. He shall hide me. I'm so glad. I'm so glad. Thank you, Lordy. He shall hide. Yes, he shall. Shall follow me all the days of my life, and I'm safe. I'm so safe in his arms. I'm safe in his arms.
Amen, amen, amen. What a joy to know tonight that you are safe in the arms of God. What a joy to know tonight that you are safe in the arms of God. Thank you, Capilia, for letting God use you tonight. The ready for us for worship tonight. Ready us in worship tonight. And give us a taste of heaven. And we praise God for you. Tonight, we are beginning a study of the book of Revelation. Tonight, we're beginning a study of the book of Revelation. I want to say tonight that we will be here for a while to understand the book of Revelation. Hebert tells us it takes a slow and purposeful study. It's a book that is often misunderstood and or misused. And this time of theological confusion, even among some of the religious elite, about what God is saying and what God is not saying, how this relates to the end times, the last days of which we have been in since Jesus' ascension, technically, how to judge the times, and what we should and should not be saying about prophecy in this dispensation is critical. And that means coming to the book of Revelation. That means tonight that we cannot study this book. We cannot afford to study this book in a way that tries to manipulate what the scripture says or is not saying. We cannot study this book to be a mental health retrieve and relaxation from the angst and confusion and worry that you and I have facing all that COVID-19 has forced us to deal with. We must approach this book in a way that is pleasing to God. That means that it's taking place with exegetical integrity. That it is following proper steps of interpretation or hermeneutics, if you will. We must present this not as a supplement to the search for vaccines and cures and when not to allow people back in intimate gatherings. We must study it for truth. And in studying it for truth, it speaks to those realities. If studying it for truth, it gives us a vaccine to man's biggest ill, which is sin, and then we have done our job. So what I want to begin tonight is this conversation is giving an overview, giving us an overview of this time together. An overview of this time together. consists of how we're going to be approaching the book of Revelation. That's an important conversation for us to have. Again, we'll be here for however long it takes us to get through this overview. And once we finish this overview, we'll go back and study it verse by verse consecutively. And so the first thing that we're going to talk about in our time together is having the appropriate approach to the book of Revelation. Number two, the background to the book. Some would call it the vital statistics. What do we need to know about the author, the place, the date, the audience, the aim or purpose of the book? We'll deal with that. We'll start that tonight. And from there, we'll go to the characteristics of the book of Revelation. What is it about the book of Revelation that makes it the book of Revelation? What is distinct about this book? What is the characteristics that we find in the construct of the book of, in the book of Revelation? And we'll go from the characteristics of it to the key question of interpretation, Tyrone. How do we interpret the book of Revelation? What is the scientific approach that we should have? Because the question about the different conclusions of the Bible, the question is, how do we get to those conclusions? I believe our conclusions would be more similar, more synonymous, if we had the same approach in our study, the same scientific, and I use that word scientific for a reason, meaning that there is some critical steps you must take in order to get to the conclusion. It's different than an art. You can go different ways and have different feelings, different interpretations, but the science of interpretation to get to the appropriate conclusion. Interpreting the book of Revelation, very critical conversation. Then the end times in the Revelation, in the book of Revelation. The end times in the book of Revelation. This is critical for us to talk about Mount Sinai. Family and friends, this is critical for us to talk about because as we approach this topic, there are so many labels, post-millennium, pre-millennium, that people throw around, even scholars, I would dare say, humbly say, and really don't understand the nuance behind why they're saying those things. And while you may not come up with where you stand, or there may not be a clear conclusion of where we will come to as it relates to these matters, there needs to be a clear understanding of the definition of these matters and what where we land at on this talk. The book of Revelation, as it relates to the end times, is why this book stands out so much. It's the only prophecy in the New Testament. It is speaking of the end of the world. These nuanced questions are always gathering around in our mind. And so we will address that here. And then we will conclude with the outline of the book of Revelation. This outline will go through how the book is presented in its symmetry and its flow. The literary build-up in the book and its literary presentation. And I believe there's movements of time there, past, present, and future, of which the bulk of the book is dealing with the future, the yet-to-be-fulfilled, the prophecy of it. And as we look at the flow of the book, under the rubric of having an understanding of the background of the book, key terms and characteristics and the end time and the structure of the book, that will enable us to study it verse by verse a whole lot better. Again, we cannot squeeze the jewels and the gems that are in the book of Revelation, by rushing through this study. And so we are going to be on cruise control. This could be a 2 to 3 to 4 year process. It could switch from Tuesday to Sunday or another time. But we are committed to marching through this and having this available on our media platform for a lifetime of indulgence, a generation of times that the Lord coming available to look back and biblical scholarly look at the book of Revelation. So let's dig in, but now going to the approach the book of Revelation. In order to do this, I want to quote Wycliffe's commentary on Revelation by William Smith. This quote, I believe, embodies the spirit of which I want us to approach this critical study. Listen to what the author says. Because of its symbolism, its saturation with Old Testament and themes, the various schemes of interpretation that's developed concerning this book through the ages, and the profundity and vastness of the subjects that are here unveiled, I believe that the apostolic, the apocalyptic, above every other book of the Bible, will yield its meaning only to those who give it a prolonged and careful study. That's the emphasis that I want you to see. That's what I want you to see tonight. I want you to see that we are here. We are approaching this book because of there's some challenges, some inherent challenges in the book of Revelation. We are approaching this in a slow, systematic way, a way that is true to the foundations of interpretation, a way that honors God, a way that is scholarly, intelligent, I dare say. Because of its saturation with Old Testament themes, another weakness that often takes place in the church. We're reading through the book of Leviticus this month, and many of you are falling asleep as a church as you read through it because it's so challenging. Those symbols in there, those rituals, those seemingly useless facts. In fact, one scholar argues that the book of Leviticus is the most important book in all the Bible. Maybe a little hyperbole there, exaggeration, but the point is that he's trying to make with that statement. Again, that is an example of a book that needs study to see the symbol of the sacrifice of Jesus Christ and how sin and the holy God requires blood because of sinful humanity. And so these Old Testament themes, these things that we have looked over because we love the gospel so much, we love the book of Acts so much, we love the simplicity of the New Testament as it relates to the revelation of Jesus Christ, his virgin birth, his sinless life, his victorious death, his supernatural resurrection, his 40 days that we're in the midst of looking at, even in our time together as a church, 40 days on earth post his resurrection, his ascension, the 10 days later, the Pentecost happens, the Holy Spirit takes place. But the Old Testament is preparing the way for all of that, and the book of Revelation is grabbing those themes and pulling them into the face of the New Testament and saying, here's how these two marry one another. It's a sacred ceremony among the scriptures that we see between the Old Testament themes and the New Testament reality. The various schemes of interpretation. No book has more ink been wasted on wrongly in trying to explain how to interpret the book of Revelation. Many who cannot grasp and the symbolisms and is unable to explain and on their comfort level what it is that John the Revelator is revealing to us through the power of the Holy Spirit and Jesus Christ. It's because of that, quite frankly, things are just made up. There's no other way to put it. It's just, we just make stuff up as it relates to Revelation. I mean, we got those horses meaning all types of stuff. And so these schemes towards the book of Revelation, there's so much literature and information, that literature that may should be litter out there about the book of Revelation. What do I listen to? And what complicates this even more, Jordan, is some of these are people who have been profoundly correct in other portions of the Bible. I won't call no names tonight. That you can trust with orthodox throughout every other page of the Bible that they study, but when they get to the book of Revelation, it gets spooky. More important, it is incorrect on a fundamental level, because much of the book of Revelation is will be revealed to us in the by and by. And that's a hard truth for Christians to deal with at times, because we want answers to everything. So that is not what I'm suggesting. I'm not suggesting that there is just some simplistic error, some oversight, some... No. I'm talking about just straight manipulation of Scripture. Same principles interpretation that is used for the rest of the book get thrown out the window when they get to the book of Revelation. Very weird thing. And this has been going on throughout the ages. Wilbert is right. This has been going on throughout the ages. There's, as he states, a profundity of vastness on this subject. And this last book of the Bible, this book of Revelation, in order to get to its true root, like anything of value that on the surface is difficult, it takes time, commitment. And it's not just time and commitment, because you can waste your time taking time, but a commitment to excellency, a commitment to honor God in presentation and study. And so I moved in the midst of this pandemic to tackle this book of Revelation, to go right in, to dig into it. And our approach, if you're taking notes tonight, which I pray that you are, and I know that this is something I just threw out more recently to you. I know we are usually more planned out and methodical, but because of what we're facing in this time and how things have shifted in this time, I'm just going right in, and you got to catch up and watch the video. And there's no way you're going to be able to understand these things that we watch. It's probably going to be at least once or twice that you have to rewatch this just to grasp some of the things we're talking about. But here, as it relates to the approach to the book of Revelation, this will be a slow study, a careful study, an intentionally prolonged study. I agree with the theologian Wilbur Smith here about that. Let's talk about the background of the book. What do we need to know as it relates to the background of the book, the vital statistics? We'll end here tonight. And in fact, we'll get as far as we can get here. And if we don't make it through, we'll pick back up. But this will definitely be the last of the major subjects that we'll touch on tonight. There's five areas of background that we have identified. There's so many more that we could dig into. But I believe these five areas are the key critical areas. These are enough. These are sufficient. These are appropriate amount for us to dig in and get into what God is leading us to do, and how we're going to make our way through this book. So let me begin tonight with the author. And from the author, we'll go to the place, the locale of the book when it was written. The date, when was it written? Not just who wrote it, not where did he write it, but not just when was it wrote, but who was he writing to? The audience. And then I believe the most critical question of it all, why did he write it? The aim or the purpose? If you're taking notes, you want to note that. You want to note that, and we'll try to get these notes available to you some way, somehow, on all our platforms. We'll try to get that to you. But if you're taking notes just for your own memory tonight, and that's the five areas that we're looking at as it relates to the background, it's the author who wrote the book. And then it's the place. Where was it written? The date. When was it written? The audience. Who was it written to? And then the aim, why was it written? / purpose. Who wrote the book of Revelation? The author of the book of Revelation introduces himself as John, a servant of Jesus Christ and a brother of the Christians in Asia. You see there in verse number 4? Then he states his name again in verse number 9. I, John, your brother and partner in the tribulation and the kingdom and the patient endurance that are in Jesus, was on an island called Patmos, and on account of the word of God and the testimony of Jesus Christ. That gets him to the place right there as well. That's a key verse, but let's just stay on the author for now. The writer of the book of Revelation is the Apostle John. The early church held this position, and we will hold it too. He is also the writer of 4 other books in the Bible, which is the letter to the church at Ephesus that we label as 1 John, one of the other books, 2 John, 2 of the other books, 3 John, 3 of the other books. 1st, 2nd, and 3rd John. And then there is the gospel according to St. John. That means in total, John wrote 5 books in the New Testament. Stay with me for a second. I'm going somewhere. He wrote 5 books in the New Testament. Mark wrote 1. Paul wrote 13, but they're not as and length as it relates to length, as it relates to quantity, as much as John. Luke wrote 2 books. He wrote 2 there, probably more in quantity, but John wrote more books. Matthew wrote 1. Jude wrote a short one. Peter wrote 3 short ones. James wrote 1, which we'll start studying the Sunday after Mother's Day, the book of James. We're unsure who wrote the book of Hebrews. But John wrote 5 books. Second in quantity of books only to Paul. And as it relates to volume, actual words written, second only to Luke. Now, why are we stressing this? Because John wrote all 5 of these books at a later age, a later date. He was an older man. John was the youngest of the 12 disciples. He was the beloved disciple of Jesus, the one that laid on his breast on that sacred night of communion. He was the one that the disciples said, hey, man, ask him who he's talking about for the betrayal. We know he'll tell you. It was that John. It was that John. Here's the point I'm trying to get to. It was the John that when Jesus was on the cross, he commissioned him to take care of his mother. Mother Day is coming up, and Jesus, when he was about to die, knowing that as the elder son, it was his responsibility to be the caretaker for mom, says, hey, John, I need you to take care of mama. He had no other earthly agenda while on the cross. Everything on the cross was solely about the salvation of man and all solely spiritual, but he pauses for this social emphasis of John to take care of his mom, and that's what John did. Peter was preaching the gospel all around the nation. Paul is starting churches all over. And John is to take care of Mary. And some would say, John, you did all that ministry with Jesus. And all you've been is a caretaker. But he kept being faithful to what God called him to do. And by the end of his life, he wrote 5 books, including probably the most, Hebert calls it the capstone of all the Bible, the book of Revelation. And he wrote it as an older man. So it's a lesson to both young and old tonight. That you're not too old to be used great by God. And don't get frustrated in your youth when God gives you an assignment that seems subservient to the assignments that he's giving your other peers. John is content with the fact that I'm Mary's caretaker. But later on, he became the pastor of the church at Ephesus, and he writes 1st, 2nd, and 3rd John. And then he says, look, man, I like Matthew's gospel. I like Mark's gospel. I like Luke's gospel. But they haven't emphasized enough about the deity of Jesus Christ. And he makes this critical, separate to the synoptics gospel, a gospel that presents the deity of Jesus Christ, begins with, in the beginning was the Word, and the Word was God, and the Word was with God, verse number 14, and we have behold his glory. He comes showing us that Jesus is the great I am that I am.
Yeah.
If he just wrote the gospel of John in those 3 letters, he'd hit a home run right there.
Come on.
But then, as we'll talk about in a second, he's cast in isolation to the Isle of Patmos, left to die. After what historians, Christian historians say, he was boiled in a pot. And in the midst of all that, God showed up and said, I need you to write some stuff down for me. That's the book of Revelation. That's our author. But let's talk about the place. We dealt with it a little bit. Now, some people would say that John wrote this in Ephesus. We do not affirm that position. We affirm the position that he wrote it on the Isle of Patmos. Why do you affirm that? Because 1 John 1 and 9 said he wrote it on the Isle of Patmos. This is off the coast of what is called is the modern day Turkey. He was in prison. He was persecuted. And he was left there to die. That's what form of punishment that was used in ancient times. They would leave people in solitude and isolation. That if you, those of you historians that may have studied the French Revolution, know this happened to Napoleon, just left by himself to rot. And while man left him to rot, God left him to write. While his persecutors and his those that doubted him, they left him there to die. God left him there because I got something deeper I want to use you for. You know what, y'all? This pandemic have many of us feeling like we're on the Isle of Patmos. We're just left in confusion. Why would God leave me in the house all by myself? Why would God force me to be in a house with these relatives that there are deep issues we have not addressed in years? And now we're forced to be with each other. And many are turning to the bottle. Many are being abusive, both verbally and physically. Police reports as scientific evidence to what I just stated.
Yeah.
Across the nation, friends. Can't go to our sporting events. And even when we go to certain places, we got to keep a certain distance and watch this, walk around with masks on our face. And everybody looking at everybody suspect.
Yeah.
Don't get too close. Was that a cough I just heard? I told someone somewhere that coughs are the new gunshots. People almost feel more secure with them saying they shooting outside than saying they coughing outside. This slow, invisible virus has taken the life of over 70,000 people in our country at this point. I believe it hit even over 71,000 before I left to walk over to the sanctuary tonight. Over a million people have been affected with it. Not counting those numbers being tripled as it relates to across the world. More than tripled. Countries like Africa that had economic issues, clean water issues before this, are now told to wash their hands. But how can we wash our hands if we don't have water to drink? How are we going to have clean water to wash our hands? How can we be socially isolated if we live in a one-room hut, two generations of families? How can we practice social distancing? How can some churches be sustained when they're worshiping under a tree every Sunday? And now you're not allowed to go outside. Martial law says that you have to be in. Pastors have to get permission slips to do funerals. This is a Isle of Patmos type feel that we're in. And just like John, we got to remember, he left us on Patmos for a reason. And he left us on Patmos for a purpose. A reason, maybe I can say it like this. We like alliterations, us preachers. A reason and a revelation. And the reason was the revelation. What is it that God is trying to reveal to us? And so maybe if we study the book of Revelation and see how he revealed the last times and just that are not yet, maybe we'll be able to understand better this thing called COVID-19, this pandemic. Maybe, Tyrone, we'll not be in such a rush as much as we miss one another, and we miss one another. The heartache to not be able to comfort one another. So our covenant says that, to comfort one another in distress.
Yes, yes, yes.
But medicine says we can't do nothing but elbow bump. So what is the revelation saying to us how we ought to do this? Maybe instead of touching each other with intimacy, maybe we need to listen to each other more with intimacy. Maybe since we can't gather together in church anymore, maybe we can spend more time being the church. Church is not a building that you go to. It's a family that you belong to. That when you find yourself in dark places, you can either think you've been buried there or you've been planted there to bloom. Either you've been placed, you can feel like you've been buried there, to die, or you've been planted there to bloom. We're in a dark place. Maybe God has planted us here as a church. I'm talking institutionally as a church. I can't speak to the American economy. I can't speak to the airlines market. I have no authority to speak there, no intelligence to speak there. I don't have their records. I don't study that background. I'm talking about the church as an institution. Maybe God has put us in this dark place for we can come out of here and bloom like we never bloomed before. But to do so is going to take some soul searching. Some uncomfortableness. If we're going to get the revelation of Jesus Christ on our Isle of Patmos, maybe we got to do more than binge watch on Netflix. Maybe instead of everybody getting on our nerves because we're tired of seeing them, maybe we need to talk about reconciliation in our homes, forgiveness in our homes. What is the essentiality of kind speech? Maybe we should not be verbally and physically abusive to one another anymore. And I would dare say even from parents to children. And you're talking to a person that would testify that spanking saved my life. But it may be an outdated mode of operation. That needs to be a serious consideration. Especially when we're doing it out of anger. That is not up for debate in my mind. Yeah, Patmos is uncomfortable. I'm going to stop there tonight. We'll pick right back up here. We'll come back next week. We'll review. We'll pick back up right there. Because I want us to really consider what it is that God is saying in the midst of this pandemic. And I don't believe that answer is on CNN. And I watch CNN every day. I don't believe that it's in the latest novel or the hottest Netflix show or movie. I'll probably watch something of that nature every day as well. But I'm in His Word too as well, and prayer as well, much more, because this is not the time. We can't play church anymore. Like, it's too serious. The stakes are too high. And I'm done. But Rich, have you noticed that the nation that was saying don't rush back is now rushing back? Now, if they are wrong, who is more prone to be hurt by this? Frontline workers, those without quality access to quality health care, and those that have high pre-existing conditions. Now, I ask you another question. What group would that affect the most? I'm not even going to do the black and brown thing tonight, even though that's the answer. I'm just going to say tonight, I am just going to say tonight, poor people. Now watch this. We're rushing back, and you got to give 46 minus 1 credit for this. They're saying it. We got to open back the country because the economy. Now, if I'm already poor, you say you're rushing back for the economy. It ain't rushing back for me. Well, then who are you rushing it back for? Those that probably have already too much money. Now we find ourselves as guinea pigs. No one will directly answer the question that the doctor that's over, I forget his name tonight, Fauci says, if we rush back, how many lives is worth it if we get it wrong? Nobody answers that question. Bill Maher wants to compare the country to Sweden and says, oh, let everybody go out and everybody go back and let it build self-antibodies. But at the expense of who? Right. Not him. Not his friends. Not his family. So there's a social consciousness that needs to be awakened in the church. I dare say even an emphasis on social justice that needs to be awakened in the church. Ironically enough, a year ago, we were told that social justice was anti to the gospel. But now we see why that is so prevalent and in line with scripture. Or maybe I'll just be up here talking sometimes. I don't know. That was sarcasm. I do know. All right, we're going to give tonight. I'm told to thank you for joining us. And I am grateful that you would join us on our live stream, watch the replay. This is a critical study for us. Join us on our worship live stream this Sunday at 9 a.m. 9 a.m. is our time. We all get to watch that together. If you miss it, you can watch the replay on our media platforms. Next Tuesday, we're continuing the book of Revelation, the study of the overview of the book of Revelation, looking at the introductory matters. And then we're going to go back after going slow through the introduction and look at every verse by verse on the book of Revelation. All our broadcasts are available for replay on our website at sinai.church. That's all you have to put in, sinai.church, or on YouTube, our YouTube channel as well. That's Mount Sinai Church, LA. Please go to our YouTube channel, even if you're not watching and you're on us tonight. Can you just go there and subscribe to it? Go there and subscribe. We'll love to get a thousand subscribers there, and we'll love to reach the 4,000 mark of hours viewed on that YouTube channel. So please help us to do so. I want to say thank you for your financial support during this season. And all I can say to you is to keep on doing that. For those of you that have reached financial hardship and difficulty, please, ma'am, please, sir, let us know how we can be of help and of assistance to you. Those of you that have not, we're asking that you would go a little bit deeper during this season in order to equip the church to be of assistance to them. So you don't want to just give to the church. You want to give through the church in various ways. Be on the lookout for what will take place this weekend as it relates to our grab and go. We're still trying to work through those details and figure out what's the best way to minister to you this weekend in light of Mother's Day. You can give tonight several ways. You can give through our website. There's a donate button. If you're watching on our website, you can just hit, or you can go there and press give. You can text give tonight. Text MSCGIVE, MSC give, to 77977, and that will help us as well. You can give through our app and go to our app, and you can give that way. Just click give, download our church app. If you haven't done so already, thank you for those who are mailing in and dropping off your offering. You can do that as well. Please, ma'am, please, sir, mail it in, drop it off. 40 Days with Jesus. Hopefully you're enjoying this journey. We're in week 4 of our devotional campaign, and the theme this week is radical giving. Check your email, your app, or our website for the daily emphasis and meditation verse. Reminders, please be reminded that we are emphasizing mental health awareness this month. Check the Monthly Informer for special articles and resources. I want to say to you that in this season, it's okay not to be okay. All of us are confused. All of us are experiencing certain levels of stress. All of us are of a certain level of frustration. Because normalcy has been taken away from us. But I do not want us to be is spoiled brats. And I don't mean to demean anyone tonight, but those that are out there protesting against the government for luxury and leisure amidst the time where there are so many people in our country on ventilators and vulnerable population is out there that is susceptible to us gathering, to spreading that. I don't want us to be that. I don't want us to be that. It's a prayer and something that I'm consciously on guard on around here, that we do not become, this is a spoiled church, but not a become a spoiled brat. You want to spoil your kids, I believe. You ought to do that. We ought to do that. But we also have the responsibility to make sure that they're not spoiled brats, not thinking that the luxuries that you partake of are necessities or obligations. They're just that, they're luxuries. And so friend, let's be in prayer for our nation, and let us be clear and be comfortable with the fact that all of us are struggling on this or some level. There's nothing to read to say how to deal with COVID-19. It's a novel virus. In our modern day time, maybe throughout world history, never has the world been asked to practice this level of social distancing for this amount of time. I never would we imagine that You wouldn't be able to come to church on Easter and Sunday morning, Mother's Day. Loved ones are dying and they can't have, we can't have services to create that closure that funerals are meant psychologically for so many. So this is a time for us to be seeking help. And I dare say to you, check on friends, check on families, check on church members. And let us be intimate in those questions. How are you doing? How are you sleeping? How are you feeling? And vice versa. When someone checks on you, be open and be transparent about how you're feeling, what you're going through. Remember the prayer line Monday through Friday, 6 a.m. to 7 a.m., 6 p.m. to 7 p.m. on Saturday and Sunday. You need no access code. Just dial that number, 508-924-3800. It's right there on the screen for you, 508-924-3800. Visit our website or check our app for other news and updates. Make sure that you stay abreast of what is taking place at Sinai Church by visiting our app and visiting our website for that information. Our social media platforms also is endowed with information as well. I'm seeking your prayer for our virtual marathon on Friday from 7 a.m. to Saturday to 7 a.m. to raise money to support the various needs of our culture during this pandemic. If you have any questions, if you have any requests, please leave a message on our office machine and someone will get back to you. Then you can also email office@sinai.church. The church office number is 323-291-1121. That's there for you as well. And then that email is office@sinai.church. All right, we're going to bless our gifts, and then we're going to be dismissed. Thank you for tuning in. Look forward to hearing you checking us out on Sunday and next Tuesday as well. Father, we are grateful and thankful for who you are. Bless gift and giver tonight. Bless your people that we will be well aware of the times and signs that is taking place in this season. Yes, for Jesus' sake, we pray and we love you. Amen.